Amittai, saying, "Arise, go to Nineveh, that great city, and cry out against it, for their wickedness has come up before me." But Jonah arose to flee to Tarshish from the presence of the Lord. He went down to Joppa and found a ship going to Tarshish. So he paid the fare and went down into it to go with them to Tarshish from the presence of the Lord. But the Lord sent out a great wind on the sea, and there was a mighty tempest on the sea, so that the ship was about to be broken up. Then the mariners were afraid, and every man cried out to his God, and threw the cargo that was in the ship into the sea to lighten the load. But Jonah had gone down into the lowest parts of the ship, and had lain down and was fast asleep. So the captain came to him and said to him, "What do you mean, sleeper? Arise, call on your God. Perhaps your God will consider us, so that we may not perish." And they said to one another, "Come, let us cast lots, that we may know for whose cause this trouble has come upon us." So they cast lots, and the lot fell on Jonah. Then they said to him, "Please tell us, for whose cause is this trouble upon us? What is your occupation, and where do you come from? What is your country, and what people are you?" So Jonah said to them, "I am a Hebrew, and I fear the Lord, the God of heaven, who made the sea and the dry land." Then the men were exceedingly afraid, and said to Jonah, "Why have you done this?" For the men knew that he fled from the presence of the Lord, because he had told them. Then they said to him, "What shall we do to you, that the sea may be calm for us?" For the sea was growing more tempestuous. And he said to them, "Pick me up and throw me into the sea. Then the sea will become calm for you, for I know that this great tempest is because of me." Nevertheless, the men rowed hard to return to land, but they could not, for the sea continued to grow more tempestuous against them. Therefore they cried out to the Lord and said, "We pray, O Lord, please do not let us perish for this man's life, and do not charge us with innocent blood, for you, O Lord, have done as it pleased you." So they picked up Jonah and threw him into the sea, and the sea ceased from its raging. Then the men feared the Lord exceedingly, and offered a sacrifice to the Lord, and took vows. So the first 16 verses of the book of Jonah. Jonah, quite a unique book in many ways, probably one of the more popular books of the minor prophets. It's one that any of us who grew up in Sunday school, you know, you hear the story of Jonah a lot. It's you colour in the pictures and you're thinking about Jonah and the whale or the big fish, as it puts it in the scriptures. One of the most kind of user-friendly books of the minor prophets. I'd imagine that most of us in here are more familiar with Jonah, the book of Jonah, the account of Jonah, than we would be, for example, of Hosea or Joel or some of the perhaps more intricate books of the minor prophets. It's not a book that's necessarily overly complicated. It's not filled with prophetic visions or apocalyptic language that we need to interpret in a specific way. It's a straight-talking narrative concerning the divine power of God and his call upon this prophet Jonah's life to the pagan city of Nineveh. Jonah also differs, just a bit of an overview really, we're going to do a few sessions in Jonah. It also differs from the other minor prophets in that Jonah, he takes a kind of anti-hero type of role. Not necessarily, his actions aren't necessarily admirable. As a prophet, he's not someone who gives us kind of an example as what we should do to follow, but really we learn by his example of what we shouldn't do. He's giving us it's more of a warning from the Lord with regards to disobedience, certainly here in this first chapter. There are some that say that Jonah is an allegorical book, that it's actually not a real historical account, but it's really a picture of Israel at that time, their refusal to carry out God's mission to the surrounding nations. There are others that say, well, Jonah's just a parable. It's just it's parabolic in nature. But I don't think either of those two claims are substantiated in the least. It's very clearly a historical book that took place. It's referenced in various sort of parts of the scripture. The Lord himself, he was speaking about the book of Jonah and the Ninevites that repented back in Jonah's day, and so on and so forth. It's a true historical, factual event that took place. Yes, a supernatural event of sorts, being swallowed by a fish for 3 days, and this mighty move of God in this great city of Nineveh. But it's nonetheless a true account, true historical reality. Jonah really also expresses to us the compassionate nature of God, the compassionate character of God, both upon the Ninevites and even here in our chapter number one on those pagan sailors that were with Jonah in the ship. Just to give it a little bit of background concerning Jonah himself before we jump into the text in just a moment. Jonah, this prophet called of God, living in a politically prosperous time of King Jeroboam II, as it tells us in verse 1, the son of Amittai. He lived in a place called Gath Hepher, which is about three miles northeast of Nazareth, where Jesus was from. He was called by God to go to Nineveh. Now, Nineveh was a capital city of the Assyrian Empire. We know that there was often conflict between Israel and Assyria, and it's modern-day Iraq. Nineveh was in what's modern-day Iraq, about 500 miles northeast of where Jonah was living at the time. So God called Jonah to go 500 miles northeast to Nineveh and to cry out against the city. It's also unique, the book of Jonah, being that Jonah is one of the only really prophets that we see with this unique mission of preaching repentance to non-Jews. The Ninevites, they weren't Jews. It was a Gentile nation, so to speak. And we see this ministry that Jonah is specifically called to by God, reaching this wicked nation, this wicked city, as we read in our early part of this chapter. So what did Jonah do? Well, he ran in the opposite direction, and God intervened. Firstly, we see a prophetic mission that was given to Jonah by God, a prophetic mission. God called Jonah and gave him a mission. We see in the very start of our text today, verses 1 and 2, now the word of the Lord came to Jonah, son of Amittai, saying, arise, here's the mission that we give. Arise, Jonah, go to Nineveh, that great city, and cry out against it, for their wickedness has come up before me. The wickedness of the Ninevites. As I've already mentioned, the Ninevites, they were this long-time enemy of Israel. We know from in Jonah that they turned away from their sin, but nonetheless, later on in history, we see God destroy the Ninevites, the city of Nineveh, and the Ninevites as a people. Nineveh was one of the more prominent cities in the Old Testament. And now Jonah doesn't give us too much specifics in the book of Jonah concerning the sin of the Ninevites, but we do see the prophetic pronouncements of judgment and the prophetic call to repent that Jonah gives to them as a city. In the book of Nahum, chapter 3, verse 1, the prophet Nahum described Nineveh as a city of bloodshed. It was a city that was at the heart of an evil empire, the empire of the Assyrians. They had a well-earned reputation for pagan idolatry, immorality, and violent brutality. It's actually reported that the viciousness of the leaders of Nineveh, they were so vicious that they wouldn't think anything of dismembering their victims, cutting off noses and the lips and fingers of any that opposed them. I even heard once that the Ninevites, the people of Nineveh were so evil, and the leaders there were so brutal and violent that they would actually often torture their people who were in opposition to them as a nation, and they would actually fillet the skin off of the people that their enemies. very, very evil and brutal. And we see here in verse 2 that their evil had reached God. Their wickedness has come up before me, says God. This is a term that's used in Scripture for other cities as well. We think of Sodom and Gomorrah. In Genesis chapter 18, the Lord speaking, saying that the evil of Sodom and Gomorrah has come up before him. In Genesis 18, it says, the outcry against it that has come to me. So we see this picture of the evil of this city being brought before God, that the outcry of this evil coming before him. And it's a similar comparison here to this city of Nineveh. So we see the call of this prophet Jonah. He was a prophet. Now a prophet is a representative of God, so to speak. It's important for us to make a distinction when we speak of prophets. The Old Testament prophets are very distinct in nature. God has given them a distinct job and a role to do. We see the prophetic office, in a sense, come to its end with John the Baptist. But prior to him, there were prophets that were called by God. We think of Isaiah, we think of Jeremiah, we think of Ezekiel, we think of here of Jonah in the minor prophets himself. They were God's mouthpiece, so to speak, speaking on behalf of God in a very specific way. And often at times to very specific people groups. We often see the phrase, as we see here, the word of the Lord came to Jonah. The word of the Lord came to Jonah, giving him this mission and this task. Now today, in the world around us, there are some who like to label themselves as prophets. I've actually spoken to people before, they've told me they're a prophet. Prophet so-and-so, and prophet this, and prophet that. And it's a very dangerous thing. We must draw a distinction between the reality of these Old Testament prophets that God has given a specific mission to accomplish, and the prophetic writings of Scripture, which are clearly applicable to each one of us today as the people of God. There are no more prophets within the same biblical way as there was in the Old Testament, as there were back then. There's no extra biblical revelation that's necessarily needed today. It can be very dangerous when people try to make claims like that. God has told me this, and God has told me to tell you this, and that, and the other. Now, we have to be very careful. There's a balance to be struck. Do I believe that sometimes God, the Spirit of God works and gives people certain impressions and things that, you know, certain things to perhaps share words of wisdom here and there and to speak to people in regard to certain situations? Absolutely. But, you know, that would always be in conjunction with the Word of God. It would always be connected to what the Scriptures are telling us. In fact, I heard one preacher once say, if you're going to start a sentence with, thus saith the Lord, then you need to be providing a chapter and verse attached with it. Because ultimately, the Lord has spoken to us in his prophetic writings, in his Word today. There are no more prophets that are given in the same way as they were in the Old Testament. It's very dangerous. It's a very easy way of people manipulating other people. You see in churches very often there'll be specific leaders that will say, well, God's telling me this, or God's telling me that. I heard one man say, well, so God's told me, he went up to a lady in the church and God's told me that we're going to get married. You hear all this kind of very abusive terminology and these practices that can take place. And it's actually not of God, it's actually of men's own inventions. So Jonah was a specific prophet. He had a message from God. He was given a message from God. We have, as the people of God, there's a sense in which we are joining with Christ. In Peter it tells us, doesn't it, that we are a royal priesthood. So there's a sense in which as Christians we have a priestly role. We have a kingly role, in a sense. We are joined with royalty. There's also a prophetic role to the Christian life. There's a prophetic role. We're called to, firstly, have we been doubted by the prophetic writings of God? Has the Word of God dealt with us? You know, it says here in in the very start of Jonah. The word of the Lord came to Jonah. Again, the word of God came in a very specific way. He was called as a prophet. But the question this morning is, has the word of God come to you? What do I mean by that? Have you experienced a time in your life where God has spoken to you very clearly in his word, ultimately centering around Christ, the work and person of Christ? Have you taken up and read of this Saviour who died for you? Has God dealt with you? Have you been reading through your Bible devotion time, your reading time, and something just hits you like a sledgehammer straight to the heart? God has spoken directly to you. The prophetic word dealing with us. We may not be called as a prophet to the nations. We may not be called like Jonah to go and prophesy to the city of Nineveh, but have we been called to be prophets to our neighbours, to those next to us, to those who we mix with day by day, moment by moment? Is there areas in our lives that God has been dealing with us over, and we've seen it in the Word? It jumped off the pages and struck us right between the eyes. It's penetrated our hearts like an arrow. Have we been obedient to his word? Perhaps things that we've been doing in our lives and we haven't seen it before, and then God shows it to us. He shows us something that he called us to do, a mission that he called us to go on. Wants us to share a word here with someone. Wants us to spend a season in prayer here for someone. Whatever it may be, a mission that God has called us to. And ultimately the Great Commission is his church, Matthew 28, he's called us. Prophetically, we've been called, again, maybe not like Jonah to the city of Nineveh, but Jesus has called his church to go therefore and to make disciples of all nations. It's easy for us, isn't it, to look at the prophets in Scripture, to look at the Jonahs and think, well, yeah, they were given a special task. You know, they were given a task by God, and that's true, they were given a task, but you know something, we as Christians have also been given a task by God. We've been given a prophetic ministry, so to speak, to be a prophet to the people around us. You know, sometimes people think that Christianity is basically just about getting saved and then coasting through life in order to just get whisked off to heaven at the end of it, and we're just going to escape this life by the skin of our teeth, and we're just going to get whisked out of here and go to heaven. But you know, we're called as his people to be prophetically involved with those around us in this world. Some people treat Christianity like a cruise ship vacation. You go and you get your ticket, you get on board the ship, you sit down and you're enjoying the view, and you're looking at the waves and the coastline as you wave goodbye to your friends. As if you're going on holiday, you're sitting on the deck of the boat and you put your feet up, you get your book out, you start to put your sun cream on, and you're watching everyone else around you scurrying around. What's everybody so busy for? Why don't we just relax? What's all the fuss about? Failing to see that the Christian faith is not actually a cruise ship, but it's a battleship, and it's heading into a war zone. And the enemy has submarines that are aimed right at you, and aeroplanes that are going to come and drop bombs aimed to try and destroy the ship. And there's a job to be done. There's work to be done. We're called as Christians to be living lives in prophetic obedience to the word of God, lives which are governed by God's word. As God advances the kingdom of his own kingdom in our own hearts, when we talk about the kingdom of God advancing, what does that mean? You know, I've shared this before. It's the reality of God advancing the kingdom in our own hearts, that we would be yielded to his will, that we would yield our lives to the will of God, and that expresses itself in our actions as we therefore grow and are obedient to his will, sharing the gospel and living a Christian life in the world in which it's placed us. It's more than just prophetic obedience. It's prophetic proclamation. Prophetic proclamation. Verse 2. Arise, go to Nineveh. He didn't just say, go to Nineveh and be an example of a good Hebrew. Go to Nineveh and be a good example of a good Jewish man. But go to Nineveh, that great city, and cry out against it. You see that? Cry out against it. We as Christians have an obligation. group to share the good news of Jesus Christ. It's not just the evangelist's job. It's not just the church pastor's job. It's not just those who have been given a specific ministry of word-based, a word-based ministry. Are there those who are given word-based ministries? Absolutely. But we have an obligation and a duty to speak a word in season, out of season. We may just fumble through the fact that, you know, over a coffee table with a loved one at Christmas time or whatever, or maybe over the dinner table at Christmas dinner, we may fumble through the gospel, we may just say to someone, you know, you need to look to Jesus. It's as simple as that. It's something of a word here, and they're being brave enough to speak out prophetically into the world around us. You know, 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 13, the Apostle Paul says, And since we have the same spirit of faith according to what is written, I believe, therefore I speak. I believe, therefore I spoke. We also believe, and therefore we speak. In Acts chapter 4, we see the early church here. It says they were praying for boldness, and when they had prayed, the place where they assembled together was shaken, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit. And look what happened when they were filled with the Holy Spirit, and they spoke the word of God with boldness. This is one of the manifestations of being filled with the Spirit of God, is that it begins to come out of the heart, the overflow of the heart, the mouth speaks. There's got to be something that comes out of our mouths. We've got to be bold enough to do that. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9. This is speaking to the church. This isn't just speaking to the apostles or to the prophets, the Old Testament. The church, you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, his own special people, that what? That you may proclaim the praises of him. You see that? The reason we're chosen, the reason we're a chosen generation, a royal priesthood and a holy nation, is so that we may proclaim. That involves speaking and proclaiming the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. See, there's something missing today in the church, in a sense, and it's a prophetic proclamation. Now, when I'm talking, there's a distinction here when we talk about prophetic ministry. I'm not talking about a foretelling, but a forthtelling. You know, the Old Testament prophets in the scripture, they foretold things that God had to say, foretold supernatural events and situations concerning future events and so on and so forth. But we as the church have an obligation to foretell. This is what this is the gospel of Jesus. This is what God says to his creatures. This is what God says to each one of us here today. He's got something to say into the culture around us. It's one of the reasons I believe, perhaps just if I could share as a side note, it's one of the reasons I believe the church is in such a mess and the culture around us is in such a mess today, is because the church has failed, it's dropped the ball when it comes to speaking prophetically into the culture. We've concentrated so long on just focusing inward, becoming insular, almost getting into our holy huddle, so to speak. But actually, when you look in Scripture at the New Testament, they went and they had something to say. When we see different situations going on in the world today with regards to equality and diversity, and this new law that's being introduced on concerning this thing or that thing, the church should have something to say into that. We should have something to speak into that prophetically. We should foretell the truth of God into the world around us. Because if we fail to do that, then the culture gathers momentum in the wrong way. And the enemy gathers ground in the wrong way. And we cease to have that impact that we should have. There needs to be a prophetic voice to the nation. It starts in the pulpits. It works through the church and penetrates the culture. See, the answer is not changing politics from the top down. Politics really comes as a result of the culture being changed, and the culture is changed when the church starts to speak prophetically into the culture. So we have a prophetic obligation. We see Jonah. We see his call as a prophet. the mission that was given, but we see an escape attempt that was futile. Jonah was given the mission to head to Nineveh. Well, what did he do? Well, surely he obeyed God, like he did what any other godly prophet should do. Any other godly prophet that's been chosen by God should do. Surely he marched that 500 miles northeast up to the city of Nineveh and he told them, this is what God wants you to do. Well, no, not at all. In fact, quite the opposite. He ran. He ran in the complete opposite direction. And running from God is a futile exercise. He ran as far away as he could. He went down to Joppa, which is modern-day port of Jaffa. Pronouncing that right, Japheth, about 60 miles southwest of where Jonah lived, and he found a ship, and he paid a fare, and he went down into the ship. It says in verse 3 that he fled, not just from the mission, not just from the ministry that he was called to, and the mission that God had called him to, but it says that he fled from the presence of the Lord, verse 3. Not just running from God, not just running from what God had called him to, but running from God himself. And this was a futile mission. Firstly, we know that you can't run away from God. God is omnipresent. He's everywhere. We know that. He sees all things. Psalm 139. Where can I go from your spirit? Or where can I flee from your presence? If I ascend into heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in hell, behold, you are there. If I take the wings of the morning and dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea, even there your hand shall lead me, and your right hand shall hold me. We have a God who is everywhere. It's a wonderful reality that we're never away from the eye of God. The eyes of the Lord are upon all people. But you know, sin, if you want to put it like this, sin in our lives can stop you wanting to be where God is. Sin in our lives can stop us wanting to be where God is. You know, when it's amazing when people have sin in their lives, just how much they try to run that. But often people who are struggling with sin, they don't want to be in fellowship. They don't want to come to church on a Sunday. They feel awkward. It makes them feel uncomfortable. They don't want to get the Bible out. They don't want to start reading on those times of devotion. They don't want to seek the Lord in prayer. Often of people who know that they're in rebellion, to whatever degree that may look like, they find going to these places and undertaking these activities, they find it uncomfortable. They want to run from God. Like, think of Adam and Eve when they sinned, they ran. They wanted to get away from him. They hid from him, hiding themselves in the bushes. But really, this idea of hiding oneself and fleeing, wanting to flee from the presence of God, it really has a deeper root. Running from God in this, a lot of people think that Jonah ran because he was scared of going to Nineveh, or he didn't want to do it because he was scared of the city, but actually there was a deeper rooted issue with Jonah. He knew that God would save the Ninevites. He had faith that God was going to do this work, that he was going to be called as a prophet, and God would save. But there was an animosity, there was a bitterness, and a disdain for the people of Nineveh. There was a prideful self-centeredness, and this prideful self-centeredness and this lack of concern and consideration for the Ninevites, but even more importantly, this lack of concern for the glory of God in the city of Nineveh, it really manifested itself with this running away from the presence of God and trying to get away from him. And you know, we can be like that, can't we, even as Christians? We have sinful ways that still need to be dealt with, and it can cause us to flee from what God has called us to do. Maybe he's called us to a certain type of ministry, or to go and speak to someone, to sow a word in someone's life in season and out of season, and we just, our sin just causes us to flee from that work, and to flee ultimately from God himself. You know, running from God can be not only is it futile, but it's a tiring business. We see Jonah must have been exhausted from the walk down to Joppa, and he's down in the boat, he's asleep in the midst of a storm, a tempestuous storm. the waves are throwing this boat. Even the sailors are running around and wondering what to do. And here's this man who's asleep. Now, this isn't, when you read this, you don't get the impression this is a peaceful rest. It's not a peaceful rest. It's something of a fleshliness, of a weariness, a fleshly sinfulness, so to speak. It's something of a disciples in the garden. Can't you keep watch for 1 hour? Watch and pray lest you enter into temptation. Something of a tiredness. The spirit may be willing, but the flesh being weak. You know, it's exhausting. Fighting against God, running from God is exhausting. There may be some of you here may even understand what that looks like, what that means. Maybe you've had times in the past where you felt in your cycle of it, there's been a cycle of disobedience maybe in your life. You felt weary. You felt spiritually tired. There's a weariness in the depths of your soul. You know something's not right. The peace that you have once had is gone. Something of a tiredness and a worn outness. You know, the only place that you can find that true rest is as we come to Christ and as we yield to the will of God for our lives. When you're not in the will of God and you know about it, it can be very weary and very tiresome. But the only place that true rest is found is as we yield to the will of God. And as we come to God and His Son, Jesus Christ. Christ is the one who gives us that peace, isn't He? Gives us that true rest to be found in Him. Do you remember in Mark 4 in Jesus? Remember the storm that they were in? There's a different storm. You know, Jonah, we'll talk about this in a moment. Jonah is a type of Christ. It's a foreshadow of Christ. And here's Jesus asleep in the stern of the boat. But this was a different type of rest. This was a rest of peacefulness. He was the man, the God-man, who always did the will of His Father. The God-man who was resting with His head on a pillow. And this is the true type of rest for us as Christians, to be found in Christ Himself. Running from God is tiring. It also, running from God has implications on others. These sailors, Jonah had run from God, and he's on the boat with these sailors. And now the sailors, these mariners, as it says to us, they were caught up in this. Jonah's sin had brought others into danger and peril. And you know, disobedience works like that. Our disobedience can end up causing others to stumble. It can bring judgment upon others. Gospel disobedience. There may be conversations that God wants to use you and to work through you to share the good news of His Son with other people. And we run the other way, and we duck out, and we dive out, and that person could end up in hell for eternity. You know, our disobedience has real consequences for other people. There may be roles as family members. We maybe those of us in here that are parents, we are called as parents to disciple our children. And we may turn from that. We may not do that faithfully. In fact, I don't think we ever. None of us are faithfully living as we should be in some ways. But you know, our disobedience in these areas can have implications on our children, on our loved ones, those around us. And God treats that very seriously. Remember what Jesus said in Matthew 18, whoever causes one of these little ones who believe in me to sin, it would be better for him to have a millstone hung around his neck and to be drowned in the depths of the sea. Woe to the world because of offences, for offences must come, but woe to that man by whom the offences come. It's a very dangerous thing to cause others to stumble. We often think about sin having personal implications, don't we? We think, I've sinned and it's going to have this implication upon me personally. But how often do we think about our sin having implications on others around us? We need to think carefully about that. Jonah's sin had implications to others around him. Here we see these sailors. Let's speak about the sailors for a moment. Hardened sailors. They would have been used to be going out on the ocean, to being in the middle of storms from time to time. But this was no mere storm. Verse 4 tells us that the Lord sent a great wind on the sea, a mighty tempest. So much so that the ship was about to be broken up. How did they respond? Well, they were afraid. They were afraid of the storm. And they were afraid even more so later on, after questioning Jonah, finding out that this storm was because of him. They became even more afraid, knowing that God's hand was in this, that God was bringing this storm upon them. And what was their response? Well, firstly we see in verse 5 that they were afraid. And it says, and every man cried out to his God. Every man cried out to his God. What was their response? Well, firstly, they started crying out to idols. They started crying out to their gods, these pagan gods. Crying out to the wrong gods. It was useless. Idolatry. And we see this around us today, don't we? We see the world around us today. All kinds of different people with different belief systems, different religious idols. The storm of God's judgment is coming, and man's fallen nature. They attempt to call out to their own idols, they call out to their own gods. And these gods can't save, these gods can't provide safety. And that's the case with idolatry. Idols are just really gods that people have made in their imagination. They have a demonic root. Paul makes that very clear. He talks about what is sacrificed to idols, is sacrificed to demons. There's a demonic root to idolatry. But ultimately, these idols can't stop the hand of God. They're of no use when it comes to providing comfort and safety. And this is what mankind has done. Mankind has exchanged the truth of God, wrote as well. Paul says that mankind has exchanged the truth of God for a lie, and they've exchanged worship of the Creator for worship of the creature. And this is what man does with idolatry. They make a god in their own imagination, and they worship this imaginary idol, but actually this idol has no power. It has mouth, it has mouth but cannot speak, and eyes but cannot see, and ears but cannot hear. It's useless, it's futile. And then what do they try and do then following this? This doesn't seem to work for them, so they throw the cargo that was on the ship over the sea to try and lighten the load. The idolatry doesn't work, calling out to these idols, these gods that are figments of their imagination, it doesn't work for them. So they begin to take matters into their own hands, throwing over the cargo from the ship, trying to lighten the load, releasing the weight. And again, mankind does that, don't they? They know something's wrong. They know that judgment is coming. There's a storm approaching. Their religion isn't working. So what can I do now? I can just turn over a new leaf. I can take matters into my own hands. Self-righteousness. Attempting to reinvent oneself, so to speak. Maybe just taking that next personal development class or becoming religious. We start going to church and lighting candles and attending small groups. I'm going to do all these different things because this is what's going to calm the storm. But you know, self-righteousness can't calm the storm either. Turning over a new leaf can't calm the storm of God's judgment. Attempting to reinvent yourself, attempting to find your inner winner, can't calm the storm of God's judgment. And that's mankind all over the world today. Mankind are trying to find, they're going to all kinds of different things to try and find peace for their souls, trying to calm this ever-increasing storm that they know is coming, the judgment of God. But it doesn't get to the root issue. It's just like putting a plaster over a fatal wound. The root issue is the sin that lies within men's hearts that needs to be changed, the heart that needs to be changed. Well, the root issue here in this place, not so much the sin that lies at the heart of men's hearts, but the sinner that was lying in the heart of the ship, Jonah, that was the root issue for them. That needed to be exposed, and he needed to be cast overboard. And then we see, just finally, this last little point on the sails. They were reaching out to their idols. That didn't work for them. They were trying to lighten the load. It wasn't working for them. So they questioned Jonah between verses 7 to 10. Why is this taking place? What's going on? And he explains that he's trying to run. He's running from the presence of God. They ask Jonah in verse 11, what shall we do? And he replies to them, pick me up and throw me into the sea, and then the sea will become calm for you. He even affirms to them what they should do. He says, you need to throw me over into the sea, and the sea will become calm for you. But then what do they try and do? Well, they carry on rowing. He says in verse 13, nevertheless, the men rowed hard to return to land. They tried to take matters into their own hands, even though Jonah had said to them, throw me over and it will be calm for you. He says they carried on rowing. It was one last-ditch attempt to make it to shore, to try and sort things out in their own way, in their own strength. And that's mankind's really the default condition. Mankind is trying to sort themselves out, trying to make it to shore in their own strength, rowing as hard as they can, fighting against God. That wasn't the way it was going to be. God had this fish prepared for Jonah. God had this situation prepared for Jonah. Look in chapter 2, verse 3, it says, for you cast me into the deep, speaking in his prayer to God. This is God's plan. Verse 14, at the end of verse 14, for you, O Lord, have done as it pleased you. This was God's plan. It was pleasing to God to have Jonah thrown overboard into that fish, because God knew that fish was then going to vomit him out later on, and that mission would be accomplished. But these men, they were taking it into their own hands. It's interesting, isn't it? They started rowing, but it grew even more tempestuous. They were fighting God, rowing against God to try and get Jonah back to the shore. But it became even more tempestuous, verse 13. You know, it's very dangerous trying to take matters into our own hands. Sometimes we can get ourselves in such a pickle with our sin. We can go down certain paths and we just think, how did I end up here? And you know what? We start to take the oars out and we start to row to get back to land. But God says, no, you've got to go over. You've got to commit your life into his hands. It's time to go overboard for this storm to cease. Just consider our last point for a moment. We've seen an escape that was futile. An escape attempt that was futile. But we see here in the wood, he touched on it a little bit, but we see here a real picture of judgment. A picture of God's judgment. We see in the storm here, and we see really in biblical language throughout. You know, we see the Red Sea coming over the Egyptians, the judgment of God. We see the flood of Noah, the judgment upon the whole world. We see the parable of the storms, the floods that are going to come, and the house that was built upon the sand would be destroyed. It's a picture of God's judgment. The sea and the tempestuous nature of a storm is a picture of God's judgment. That's why when Jesus stood up and calmed the sea in Mark 4, showing that he's the one who has that power over these storms of judgment. God is a just and righteous God. He's a God that will be just. We were talking the other week, weren't we? Hebrews 1. He's the King who's on the throne. And your throne, O God, is forever and ever a scepter of righteousness. God is a righteous judge. The Bible says even the very foundation of his throne is built on righteousness and justice. Now that's a good thing. It would be terrible if God was corrupt, or God took bribes, or God had some sin in him where he could kind of be defiled or be twisted or be a corrupt judge. That would be a terrible thing. It's good that God is good. It's good that he's righteous. But it also poses a real big conundrum to mankind, because mankind is unrighteous. Mankind is sinful. And therefore, mankind will be judged for their sin outside of Christ. You see, we as human beings, we have such a tendency to let sin slide, or to treat sin casually, or to make excuses for sin in our own lives. Oh, sorry, I got angry with you, I was just really tired earlier. You know, that guy who's gone off the rails, he had a bad upbringing, so, you know, he's dealt a difficult hand in life, so that's why he killed that person. You know, mankind has this real way of trying to justify excuses for sin, but, you know, God doesn't do that. God doesn't justify people's sinful actions. Mankind will stand accountable before God to give an account, the Bible says, for every deed that has been done in the body. God is a just and righteous God. He's the perfect God who judges perfectly, who does all that pleases him. Psalm 105. God had called Jonah to a specific work, and this judgment was coming because Jonah rebelled against him. The judgment of God was falling upon that ship. It was a judgment that had been recognized. I've already talked about this, I won't talk too much, but that even the mariners, they recognized that this was divine judgment. They said in verse 7, who's caused this trouble to come upon us? They knew something that upon this wasn't just like a bit of cloud cover and an unusual storm. They knew that God had brought this storm. Who has caused this trouble to come upon the ship? And then they cast lots. Interesting, isn't it? I mean, I wouldn't recommend casting lots. There are some Christians that have done that in the past. I think even, I want to say, even John Wesley was involved with something like that. Forgive me if that's not quite right, but these individuals, they cast lots, and God worked through that process to show them it's Jonah. It's the one who's asleep in the boat. He's the one for the reason for this storm. They recognized it as God's hand of judgment. Again, as we looked earlier, chapter 2, verse 3 and verse 14, that it pleased God. You know, mankind recognizes that judgment is coming. As much as humans try to they'll not want to acknowledge the existence of God. God has written eternity on the hearts of all men. Mankind knows that there is a judgment coming. And when they die and stand before God, then the Bible says that mankind will be without excuse. Romans chapter 1 says they will be without excuse. That's a fearful and terrifying thing, to fall into the hands of the living God. To fall into the hands of God's judgment is a fearful and terrifying thing. And there is a day where every human being will stand before Christ, and there won't be anyone on that day say, oh, what do you know? You are real after all, and trying to make excuses. There's going to be no excuses on that day for anybody. It will be a fearful day to fall into the hands of the living God, the hands of his judgment. Everyone will acknowledge Christ's right to judge. Either mankind is going to die either there, or Christ is going to return beforehand. But when he returns, everyone will recognize Christ's position and his right to judge his creation. Because he made all things in us, and all things have been made by him, through him, and for him. And he's been given all the authority to judge. There was a judgment that was recognized, but there was a judgment that was satisfied. The judgment satisfied. They cried out to the Lord, verses 14 to 16. We pray, O Lord, please do not let us perish for this man's life, and do not charge us with innocent blood, for you, O Lord, have done as it pleased you. So they picked up Jonah, and they threw him into the sea. And look at this, and the sea ceased from its raging. Threw Jonah into the sea, and the sea ceased from its raging. Now, listen to this, is interesting. Verse 16. Then the men feared the Lord exceedingly, and offered a sacrifice to the Lord and took vows. No amount of rowing could stop us. No amount of throwing the weight on the side could calm this storm. No amount of praying to their idols Jonah needed to go over the side. And as I said at the start of the sermon, this Jonah, this example is a type, it's a foreshadow of Christ. It's a foreshadow of Christ. I mean, even in the even in the Gospels, we see Christ himself says, for as Jonah was 3 days and nights in the belly of the great fish, so will the Son of Man be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth. What we see here is a picture of substitution. We see here one going into the water to save others, one taking the judgment, going into the storms of judgment, so that those storms may be stilled. You know, in Revelation chapter 4, it speaks of the four living creatures around the throne. It says that there was a sea of glass like crystal in the book of Revelation around the throne of Christ. So the sea there is not a tempestuous storm, but it's a sea of glass like crystal, as calm as crystal glass. And these four living creatures were around the throne crying, "Holy, holy, holy Lord, God Almighty, who was and who is and who is." And what you see there is a picture of the judgment that's been stilled, the judgment that has been taken and dealt with. Jonah was thrown overboard and his sea became calm. And just a few hundred years later, Christ, the Son of God, would be thrown under the judgment of his Father, so to speak. So the storm of God's judgment that's due towards us for our sin would become calm, so that we could be considered innocent in light of God's sacrifice, the sacrificial death of his Son. See, Jesus Christ was the only one who can calm the storm of God's judgment that's due towards us. When it talks about building your house upon the foundation, that foundation is the rock of Christ. It's not on religion, so to speak. It's not on your best efforts to make it to shore. The foundations of our life must be built upon the sacrificial work of Christ. We must be resting upon this one who took the judgment in our place. Now the difference is here between Jonah and Christ is that Jonah was a sinful man running from God, and he was thrown over and the storm ceased. But Christ is the perfect man who willingly came and perfectly gave his life, and he was cast into that storm of judgment, so to speak, so that we in turn could be saved. And then finally now, not only was it a judgment that was satisfied, a picture of the judgment that was satisfied, but we see here a judgment that bore great fruit. It bore great fruit. Jonah, in verse 10, he realized he had to go overboard. He'd already confessed to the people, to the sailors. Verse 10b says, "For the men knew that he fled from the presence of the Lord because he told them." Jonah confessed. He told the men that he fled from the presence of the Lord, that he was the reason for this problem, that he was the one who was causing this storm to come upon them. He knew that his only option was to go into the sea. Verse 12, he said to them, "Pick me up and throw me into the sea." So you see the fruit of confession here. And mankind needs to realize that there is a judgment coming, and that we need to confess. We need to be realistic about our lives before God. We're not going to escape the judgment by just trying to find our inner winner or pulling ourselves up by our bootstraps. We need to be realistic. In fact, one of the first points of a person's conversion, I know certainly in my own life, is I realized that I was guilty. That I realized that I deserved the judgment of God. I don't believe a person can be truly saved until you understand that you are guilty and you deserve the judgment of God. Mm-hmm. Has that happened to you? Have you understood that you are guilty before God in your own sin? Has there been a point in your life where you've realized that you are deserving of judgment? Because that's the entry point of salvation, because it's only then can a person look to Christ. And the cross doesn't make any sense if you don't believe and understand that you're guilty, that we're guilty in that sin. The cross of Jesus doesn't make any sense. And Jonah realized that he was guilty. He confessed that he was guilty. He said, He confessed to the sailors, I've been running from the presence of God, you need to throw me overboard. He was obedient. He was obedient. He encouraged them to throw him over. In one sense, this must have taken great faith. We don't get the impression from this chapter here that Jonah was running and holding on to the beams at the bottom of the ship. Don't throw me, don't throw me. In fact, if anything, he said to them, throw me over. And they decided to carry on rowing for a short time until they realized it was futile. See, there was something here of an obedience that Jonah realized, it's time that this is sorted out. I can't run from God. I can't keep running in my sin. This needs to be sorted out. Maybe there's sin in our lives today. Maybe we've been running from God. We've been doing things we know, saying things or not doing things that we should be. And we know that God's dealing with us. We like Jonah, need to come to the point where we need to go into the water. We need to go overboard and get onto the mission that the Lord's called us to. And even the sailors, to some degree, they have great faith. You get the impression that there was a reluctancy about them throwing it over, but they knew that that's what had to be done. They prayed to God about it, but they weren't throwing him over with malice or ill intent. They prayed to God, and then they took him and cast him into the sea. I'm sure they weren't taking pleasure in doing what they were doing as such, but they knew it was the right thing to do. And as Christians, we need to be obedient to what God has called us to do. And then very finally, not only is it judgment it bore great fruit. We see the confession, we see obedience, but it brought glory to God. It brought glory to God. We see these men, they prayed and they cried out to the Lord. They weren't crying out to their idols anymore. You know, in verse 5, they cried calling out to their idols, save us. Now here they are calling upon Yahweh, the God of Israel. Calling to God. They saw the power of this one true God of Jonah. That he was the one who was in charge of these storms. In charge of all things. They now had a healthy fear of God. And they offered sacrifices to the Lord, taking vows. The last verse that we read here today. You know, that's the picture of the Christian life. When we come and we understand that we deserve judgment. When we look to Christ, there's something of those fears and those fears that are ungodly, so to speak, initially. Those fears are removed and we have a real sense of the fear of God within our lives. In Mark chapter 4, when Jesus calms the storm, we see a God-fearing group of disciples that have a new approach to this one who stood with them in the boat. May we be a people like Jonah, in a sense that we would commit our lives to the hands of God, that we would say, God, we've been running, or if we've been running from him, that we would turn back and we would become obedient, that we would become confessional, that we would realize that God is in charge, that he's called us to a work. You know, as Christians, we've been called to a work, a gospel work. We've been called to a certain way of living, a certain life that he's called us to. And sometimes, you know, God has to chasten us with storms. He has to bring things into our lives to show us that change is needed, direction is needed to be changed. May we be a people that would look to Christ, this one who was thrown under the judgment of God in our place. And like these sailors, as Jonah went into the water, they feared God in a healthy way. And they cried out to the one true God. And they prayed to him, they offered sacrifices to him. May we offer our bodies, as Paul puts it in Romans, that we would offer our bodies as living sacrifices to Christ. That we would commit our lives to him. And then in turn we would be glorified as we walk the walk of faith. Let's pray together.